I'd like to call to order this study session of District 116 for March 7th, 2017. Roll call, please.
Member Carter.
Here.
Member Hall.
Here.
Member Patton.
Here.
Member Pulaski.
Here.
Member Fisher is here. Vice President Rollins.
Here.
And President Demmett.
Here. Are there any additions, corrections, or modifications to this evening's agenda?
No, there are not.
All right. Next is citizen statements, and in order to address the board, you need to fill out a goldenrod sheet and turn that into our recording secretary, Lori. So to give everybody a chance to do that, if you haven't already done so, we have some up here all ready to go. But if anyone else wishes to fill one out, please do so while we're underway. And while you're thinking about that, I'd like to recognize Stephen Thompson for running the cameras for us tonight so the folks at home can watch.
All right.
So we'll go ahead and get started. I want to remind everybody about the rules. 5 minutes, please. Please, when you come forward, provide your name and address. And we'll go from there. The first on our list is Yolanda Cook. And after that will be Amanda Ludeman, if I pronounced it correctly. Yolanda.
No, I'm just Yolanda.
I know you're...
Yolanda.
Oh, Yolanda.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
I don't know about these things. Hi, good night. I, Yolanda Cook, 2109 Clover Court West Champaign. I'm a staff member at King School. And I am just here tonight on behalf for myself and on behalf of one of Jennifer's former parents. I would like to say that I never thought that I would be here, but the morning after the last meeting, I woke up and the first thought that I had was what grace, what poise that Jennifer is handling the situation with. And so I just thought that I would like to publicly say that. Mm-hmm. So that is what I would like to share for myself and to thank you because you are being such a role model at this time for the rest of us. I don't think that I would have been able to handle it this way, but now just observing you these past weeks and months, I would like, were I ever in a situation like this, to handle it like you are. And then I'm also here on behalf of, Mr. Timothy Warren Sr. He was at my office last week, and he said, oh, I see, he couldn't remember your name. He said, oh yeah, I said, Dr. Ivy Dayton, he said yes. And he said, you know, I wish I could be here, but he said, could you share something on my behalf? And what he would like to say that is on behalf of him and his family, that he has really appreciated all the kindness and assistance that you've shown to them over the years, especially they were gone for a few months and they returned last year. And he said that you were one of the two people that helped him the most to make sure that his children were re-enrolled in USD 116. So I would like to share that to the board to let you know. Thank you.
Thank you. Amanda Ludeman, followed by Carlos Donaldson.
Good evening. My name is Amanda Ludeman, and I'm a special education teacher at King School. I'm currently in my seventh year of teaching, with five of them being in Urbana. I come before you tonight to show my support for Dr. Jennifer Ivory Tatum in her current position as Deputy Superintendent. To begin, I want to talk about my very first memory of Dr. Jennifer Ivory Tatum, which was during my interview for my current position. Out of the many questions that were asked of me, one has stuck with me until this day. And that question was, why do I want to work for Urbana? My answer, I wanted to work for a school district that honored diversity, that respected and celebrated every child, parent, and staff member, and that they are each beautifully unique in their own way, let it be race, religion, gender, etc. After working for 2 years in a district where every single child, teacher, and administrator looked like me, I wanted to work with and for and to teach those with different backgrounds than myself, as I knew the most powerful lessons come from those with different experiences as mine. You learn the most when you are truly willing to listen and truly hear what others have to say. Dr. Jennifer Ivory Tatum is the epitome of cherishing diversity. For the past month or so, I have not felt or seen the same love for our district as I did before. We have become quite divided, and I know that is not what we want to be recognized for. I implore the board to say no to any new position that is suggested for Dr. Jennifer Ivory Tatum to be put in. She must stay in her current position. As far as I can tell, there's no feasible reason to restructure central office. This is not how positive change, solid change, comes about. We preach to our students every day, don't be a follower, be a leader. Don't make bad choices because your friends have done so. So why should we, as a district, and you as a board, let this happen? Why are we trying to change something that's not broken? Thinking that putting Dr. Jennifer Ivory Tatum in a position anything less than what she is currently in just isn't fair. By creating a position especially for her, putting her in possibly Jennifer Frerich's position is not okay. We need her experience. We need her leadership. We need her drive. We need her ability to question those above and below her. We need her love for every single child, family member, staff member, community member in Urbana. We need her elementary school experience. We need her special education experience. We need her so that students of color and females can look up to her and have something to strive for. We need her to be the voice of solidarity. We need her for her ability to make positive changes that affect us all. We need her for her loyalty. We need her for her vision surrounding our district. We need her for her positive attitude. We need her for her level-headed decision-making abilities. And above all, we need her to stay in her current position of deputy superintendent. Thank you.
Thank you.
Carlos, and then after Carlos, Carletta Donaldson.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I am back sooner than I had planned. I have some questions and suggestions for the board. An email was sent out about Dr. Tatum being reassigned in the fall to Thomas Paine. Was there another email sent to retract the previous email? Again, was this the board or superintendent's idea? Was the full board aware of this decision before the email was sent out, or was it just a decision made before board approval? The reason I ask this, that I know how boards should perform and their duties from experience. Select members of board meet without other board members' knowledge. I was told about a special meeting that was to be held for one thing, and they were meeting about something else. The situation was I and another board member had agreed to chaperone an event for a junior high school out in St. Joe. We both had children at the junior high. At the last minute, the other board member backed out of the chaperoning, and I, upon arriving at St. Joe, found out that they had enough chaperones. So I, in turn, decided to go back to the special meeting. I drove back to Urbana, and the other board members were present along with the other board members and an attorney when I walked in. You guessed it. They were surprised and tried to change the reason they had convened the meeting. The lawyer reminded them why they were there, and had him there, which was to discuss the firing of an administrator at the junior high school. He was eventually fired and paid a settlement by this district. I was outnumbered in the vote, but he was able to obtain another job as either superintendent or assistant superintendent in Northern Illinois, in a school in Northern Illinois. I was involved in his replacement and was for hiring someone within the district, and the other board members were for a person from a suburb of Chicago. I and two other board members for the candidate, which was in the district, and the other four members for hiring the candidate from Chicago. That didn't look very good from a highly regarded position, and a vote of 4-4 and 3-against. So the other four gave in, and the local candidate was hired and worked out well, eventually leaving the area to do even greater things. We have been waiting on a board vote, but an email has already been sent out confirming the transfer. The board should be setting policy, and superintendent should make the district run smoothly and its daily operation without creating confusion among staff and students and their families. And all of these deputies and assistant superintendents have their duties to do the same under the superintendent's guidance. My main issue is, is the board ready to push the current superintendent out and doesn't want to put Dr. Tatum in for some underlying reason, as history will show that she is the next best qualified candidate to do so? I would ask that publicly either the superintendent or the board president, admit whose decision this was. As I have sat where you are now, I've sat there, and I know how boards operate. There's always a bully, and usually that bully gets its way. I would hope that this is not the case here, but if it is, if Dr. Tatum is reassigned, this whole board, this community, should be asking for you to step down, whether there's something that you, as the chairman, the president of the board, have over the superintendent. The superintendent is supposed to run the district, as I mentioned. The policy of the board is to set policy, not run the district. I would hope that this is not what's happening now. Thank you.
Carlotta, followed by Erin Evans.
Carlotta Donaldson, 406 Brookings Drive. Before I get started, at the last meeting I attended, there was discussion about the calendar, and a board member mentioned the Martin Luther King Jr. celebration weekend. It's always the same time every year, and it's not a separate event on that Friday with Parkland. It just happened to be at Parkland the last couple of years, and of course next year it will not be at Parkland. So just to make that note, that it's something on Friday at 4, that's countywide, Sunday at 5 at Cranert, and then Monday morning before the day of service at the venue at the breakfast. So now the reason why I'm here. My dad basically said a lot to think about. And again, the retraction of the email. Once again, I ask, what's next? Educating the students and their families, the staff and community on board policies and procedures, and it might also help a few of the board members and current administrators, but this might be something implemented into the board meetings to help us understand what is really going on. Still, I'm receiving calls from and talking to many who have been former members of the board, have been staff, students, parents, and community, reminding us what would have happened and where would we be now had the board not approved the promotion of then Deputy Superintendent Owens when then Superintendent Dr. Preston Williams had a chance to submit to the board his choice for deputy. What does the current board think of that voting decision in light of quite a few of the current members were involved in that vote? Now, we're all human and have feelings, sometimes used against us, depending on who feels what. But board, let's clear this up today and move on to other things more important and pressing in this district, like a bigger board meeting room to accommodate any size crowd that chooses to attend a meeting. And I know we sit here and laugh about that, but this is serious. There's other things to deal with. I mean, spring break is coming up. People have things to do. Our kids are getting ready to graduate. Different changes, we need to be thinking about more than trying to mess with the livelihood of one person. Board, thanks for what you do, and to the comments that I've received from those who have served on school boards, and know that I'm one of your biggest advocates for some type of pay. As a matter of fact, I brought it to the Urbana City Council when they were discussing raises for themselves. So isn't it nice to be elected and be able to completely control your pay? I also tell young people, you will never be paid for what you believe you are worth doing when it's a service that helps the entire community as a whole. But when you choose that's volunteer to step in, run for elected office, hopefully intending to make a positive difference in the position, you should do it with the same integrity, fairness, and willingness as you would have had you been paid something. Again, I know that you work hard at what you do, so let's just show the state again, even after 51 years, that the school district in Urbana can be the leaders in really treating our staff, students, their families, and this community right, and that is why we will continue to improve what we do for everyone. So please, now we talked to Dr. Owens a little bit before the meeting tonight. He said, and correct me if I'm wrong, that it was his decision what's going on with Dr. Ivory Tatum. There will be no board vote, he's saying tonight, but if an email was sent out, that's a decision that's been made. Again, as someone said before, the date, time, location, where she's gonna be. So if the board's not in it, then I ask you and I urge you to lean on Dr. Owens to get this right, get this right. And then hopefully we can get something out tonight, send an email out retracting what was there because Dr. Tatum will stay in her position and let everyone enjoy their upcoming spring break. Again, thanks for what you do.
Aaron?
Good evening. Aaron Ammons, 1108 North Busey in Urbana. I won't make any comments about my pay as an Urbana City Council member. I'll wait till next Monday to do that. So I'm actually coming as a parent. I have a 15-year-old freshman. We have been in baseball practice the all evening long. But I'm coming to speak as a parent, but also as someone who has worked on a lot of different issues in this community. And it's still troubling to me that we would still be with this particular issue. Now, I agree with the earlier speaker who said that, first and foremost, my conversations with the people in the community overall who have students and who work for this district, there is no compromise. Dr. Tatum stays in her position, in her current position. Now, barring some sort of egregious violation, such as nepotism, gross insubordination, sexual misconduct, misappropriation of funds, something along those lines, which would lead to a closed session where all of the board members would be there, not just Mr. Dimmitt and the president and the lawyer or something like that. If I'm misspeaking, I'm not saying that that's what happened. What I'm saying is that it's my understanding that as president, you have some leeway that maybe some of the other board members don't have if you wanted to have a meeting with the lawyer or something like that. Okay, that's good to know. I think the public wants to know that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. The point being for us is that, and from my perspective, if there was something egregious, then there would have been a closed session meeting with all of the board members and something more severe, such as termination, would be being discussed, right? So I'm just trying to wrap my head around, as we said before, and I think it's good for the public to try to understand. When you look at the flow chart where it says Urbana citizens and the students are the ones who really make the decisions about how the direction of this district, and I look at the superintendent role, the Board of Education role, the superintendent's role, and the deputy superintendent, and then there should be assistant superintendents, then directors, and then principals. So based upon the proposal that we have heard, initially in particular, which was that Ms. Tatum would be moved from next in line to be superintendent to a principal, which in essence would go from deputy superintendent past assistant superintendent, past director, all the way down to principal at an elementary school. So I just think people need to kind of understand the breakdown of what that looks like. So if there's no egregious violation like nepotism, misappropriation of funds, gross insubordination, sexual misconduct, what in the world brings us to the conclusion, or Superintendent Owen or Mr. Dimmitt or the board here, to the conclusion that she should be demoted that many steps below where she is now? Past assistant superintendent, past director, down to principal. That was the initial proposal. So we're just trying to figure out, because see, we've been in these situations before, and I have sat in this seat before, where it doesn't take much for a black woman to be pushed out of a position that she has earned. See, I remember that very vividly, sitting in this room when a black woman is pushed out of a position that she has earned, right? And some of you were here when that happened. Some of you in the current positions that you're in now were here when that happened. So to us, and I don't just in this position speak as for the black community, we have, our community has a qualified, deserving individual who happens to be a black woman. And of course, we went from Black History Month to Women's History Month, and now we're still dealing with the same issue. Who's qualified, who's deserving of the position that she's in. So to have any conversations about demoting Ms. Tatum only guarantees you that we're going to continue to come back here, and this district will unfortunately continue to get the spotlight put on them that we really don't need to have on us at this particular time. So board members, if Dr. Owen will not rescind his proposal, then why don't you guys, I'm asking you guys, to simply say, we're not supporting this. This is not in the best interest of our children, of our district, and anybody as we go forward. So that's what I'm asking you all to consider when you sit back and you think about this decision when it comes to you, if and when it comes to you, to just simply say, no, we're not doing that. So let's go back to the business that we've been doing, and let's get our baseball team winning some games. Thank you all. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Laurie, do you have any more? Laurie, any more? Anyone else wish to address the board? Please come forward and provide your name, please. Name and address, since you have not filled out a form.
Absolutely. Andy Bonner, 308 East Oregon Street, apartment 1/2, Urbana. Mm-hmm. All right, my name is Andy Bonner, and I am lucky enough to be a sixth grade math teacher at Urbana Middle School. I should also mention that I am a non-tenured teacher, and up until now, I've been working more behind the scenes to show my support for Dr. Ivory Tatum. People are afraid to come forward and stand up for what is right because they fear what repercussions await them. Many non-tenured teachers are worried that they will lose their job if they voice their concerns because it seems that standing up for what you believe in could lead to a potential demotion. I've decided that I can sit quietly no longer and need to speak my truth. I believe that Jennifer is not only the most qualified, but also the most genuine person we have in a leadership position in this district. She is kind, supportive, and an advocate for all. Up until recently, I've agreed with just about everything that central office decided. This includes equity initiatives, the push to move towards standards-based grading, and even our snow days. I have adopted restorative practices techniques with my students and coworkers. I'm piloting standards-based grading this year, and I stayed home on the days I was told to do so. Our recent restructuring plans, however, leave me feeling very upset. I've always looked up to Jennifer because she's a fantastic leader. Her grace, compassion, and ability to make everyone feel welcome and wanted reassured me that I belonged in this district from the very beginning. As I grew to know her better last year while I had Jordan in class, I learned she is truly a teacher leader. She was and still is willing to offer advice or help with anything I need. She listens to my assessment ideas and gives me feedback on lessons I want to implement. I realize that central office staff members are very busy, but I appreciate that she takes the time to truly get to know her Urbana family. Anyone that knows Jennifer knows she is easy to talk to. Many people have shared about her ability to collaborate, but for some reason that is now up for discussion. We heard at the last meeting that Don and Jennifer were talking again. I took that to mean they had stopped. How could she possibly collaborate with the central office staff when she is not given the opportunity to speak to others? I attended the restorative practices workshop a couple weekends ago, and one of my major takeaways was that I needed to be more restorative with my peers. Jennifer heard me share this with the large group because she was there to support us. It wasn't until last Tuesday that I started taking the necessary steps to be more willing to share my mistakes and truly work on building relationships with others. I'm going to be honest, it was not easy sitting in front of my team and admitting my wrongdoing. That being said, we've never been stronger. This team, this Urbana family, needs to sit down together and work on rebuilding. You all have the opportunity here to do the right thing, but there's fear of being wrong. I'm asking you to have the courage to stand up for what's right and keep Jennifer in her current position.
Anyone else? Again, please name and address since you did not fill out a form.
Yep, sorry. My name is Elaine Duran, 35 Colony West, and I'm reading a poem on behalf of Kara Morizzi, since she could not be with us here tonight. So here goes. I'm so sad, the people said, and some were even pretty mad, for something very, very bad was happening in Urbana. The board just nodded and shook their heads. While hundreds came filled with dread, we need to keep her here instead, working for Urbana. For Dr. Jennifer, JIT, she works for you, she works for me. She's the voice we need, you see, singing for Urbana. For teachers, principals and staff, students, families, she walks the path. Why must she feel this undue wrath while fighting for Urbana? Don't let her go, the people cry, and the numbers continue to multiply. We need the board to justify this action in Urbana. Okay, okay, you'll get your way. We'll find a place for her to stay. Now please, will you just go away? Go back to work, Urbana. What does that mean? You'll keep her here as deputy? The choice is clear, but it isn't deputy we fear, just a placeholder for Urbana. We need you to keep her in her post. That's where she can do the most. About here, I'm sorry. About her, we will always boast. She does so love Urbana. We will not say it's well. This isn't sitting very well. There's no reason, far as we can tell, to restructure Urbana. You promised talks, but it's not fair to only talk with cameras there. The media may be unaware, but not us in Urbana. She wouldn't just sleep quietly, and soon the people started to see discord with racial equity initiatives in Urbana. It's not because she's black or white. This is a very different fight. You can't remove race, try as you might, from the issue in Urbana. So where's the decision coming from? Is it really what you want, just yes men and agreeing pawns working in Urbana? I thought we wanted higher thought, questions, challenges. Instead, we're wrought with executive orders that ought not happen in Urbana. If we as a district are to succeed, we need a leader who will lead. A restructuring isn't what we need to function in Urbana. There's something dangerous going on, and what's happening to Jennifer is wrong. Swallow your pride and get along. Do it for Urbana. Strength isn't strong enough a word, for no one ever has deserved to serve as deputy where she serves more than Jennifer in Urbana. We won't settle till she stays as deputy through all of her days. If she leaves, the price we pay is a broken Urbana. Thank you.
Anyone else wish to address the board this evening? Anyone else? All right, seeing none, we'll move on. We do have a call for an exec session after tonight's current meeting for the purposes of discussing personnel. There'll be no action afterwards. We need a motion to approve the agenda for this evening.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motion is carried. We have no administrative briefings or reports tonight. We do have a study topic. Jennifer?
Okay. I am going to invite up a couple of our committee members. Joe Wiemelt, Director of Bilingual and Multicultural Programs, Mrs. Smith, and Ms. Jackson, Principal and Assistant Principal at Dr. Williams Elementary. We also have a couple other committee members, I believe, in the audience, but I think Janice Mitchell and our Darcy Silver is here somewhere. And I didn't see Nichelle, our teacher. Is Nichelle here? Okay. So we've had a committee and we've been talking about the enrollment concerns. So I'm gonna be kind of walking us through the handout that you have. And we've met several times, and Mrs. Smith and Ms. Jackson, the committee really wanted to hear from them about what they really felt like they'd like to see, and since then we've just kind of moved forward with our plan is to discuss capping the enrollment at Dr. Williams for next year. As you've seen on your enrollment reports, their numbers have hovered around the 500 level for the majority of the year. As students leave, you know, they have high mobility, so we have had students leave, but of course other students come to take their place, don't they? So it has been pretty much throughout the school year where they've been somewhere between 490, 496, 495, 500. So we as a team have talked about some supports that we can put there. I know we've added some additional special education supports. We've added Title I intervention. We've been working to get additional bilingual supports there. but we've also added hallway and some. So we've tried to really put some extra supports there just so it's manageable. But anybody who's been in the building and seen 23 classes moving throughout the school with 500 bodies, no matter how much additional teacher or TA support that we put there, it's just a lot of children. So one of the things that Don kind of charged us with, and the board knew that we were really talking about this, in lieu of us doing some redistricting, we do need to talk about how we can get some relief for the building. So one of the ways in which we're going to do that is capping for next year. The number that we'd like to explore capping at would be 435. When the building has been at 435, possibly 445 if we have to, we feel like it's much more manageable for our administrative team, for our dual language programs, basically for all the support people that are there. Space is an issue. We have, in some cases, specialists that we have 3 and 4 people in a room sharing space. And you can imagine if you're trying, if one of Todd's special ed teachers is trying to pull a group, and a Title I teacher is pulling a group, and another special ed teacher is pulling a group, that it's near impossible to get small group instruction. They have spaces where people are meeting in the libraries, in the back corner of wherever they can pull students at this point. That's what's happening. And so we've really talked about that number. So it wasn't just a magical number that we pulled out of the sky. We really felt like that is a very manageable place to put the building. To get them back in line with our other elementary buildings, and to give them some space relief as well. So what would happen in terms of class size configurations? Right now we know that we have a large incoming kindergarten group. So we are going to open 4 kindergarten classrooms. 2 would be English only and 2 will be dual language. We plan to start those 4 classrooms basically full at 21 or 22 students, and then that would be the end, and we wouldn't accept any new kindergartners throughout the year. So there would be 88 spaces for kindergartners to be enrolled. There are currently 426 K-4 students who will be our first grade through fifth grade group next year, and we have been working with families. We've been sending out we sent the pre-enrollment forms out several weeks ago, and those have been coming in. They continue to come in. And on that form, we asked families to indicate if they're going to be returning for the 17-18 school year. But we're also trying to find out who other kindergarten students are who may not be in programs like Head Start or Early Childhood, to get the word out to other families about the need to get in and register early this year. We are planning multiple registration opportunities for families to try to get as many of the current 426 students enrolled by the end of the year. So Kathy and her team and all of us, so we can make decisions related to the number of classes, the number of teachers who'll be teaching those classes. But in order to make those decisions by the end of the school year, we need as many of those folks to get in as register as soon as possible. These are some of the opportunities that are coming up. We have parent-teacher conferences very soon, March 16th and 17th. And during parent-teacher conferences, Darcy Silver and the kindergarten team will be registering at Urbana Early Childhood. That's not on your sheet, so that's new. I forgot to add that one, so you might want to write that down. Urbana Early Childhood registration will be Thursday from 8:30 a.m. to 8 p.m. Mm-hmm. And Friday, 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. And we'll be advertising these in the community, and they have already been doing that at Dr. Williams. And Darcy has already been sending out information to the families that we know of at Urbana Early Childhood and at Head Start. Dr. Williams will be holding registration in their multipurpose room for the students, that the incoming kindergartners that we're finding out about from our pre-enrollment forms. And their registration will be March 16th, 4 to 7:30 p.m. and March 17th, 8 to 10:30 a.m. So I'm saying this not just for you, but for the listening audience as well, so hopefully. There will be a dual language forum held on March 28th at 6 p.m. at Dr. Williams, and there will be registration opportunities there. And then a Walkins One event. We've talked with Dr. Owen, and I need to get on advertising that a little bit more, but the plan is that we would hold our own walk and get out in the neighborhood and get the information out about Kindergarten Connection, which is on April 11th, and we'll do that on Thursday, April 6th. So hopefully very soon you'll have a Google sheet coming out. I know a lot of you have walked and Walk is One events in the past, and audience, anyone who wants to come and walk with us on Thursday, April 6th, you're welcome to join us. So our plan is to get that information out, get as many families registered as we possibly can so we can make some planning decisions for the 17-18 school year. I know one of your questions is, okay, when we've reached that 435 students, where are the other students going to go? And that's something we've talked a lot about and our administrative team. Some possibilities include Thomas Paine, basically because Thomas Paine is close. Yeah. Thomas, a lot of the students who live in the Thomas Paine area are still a mile and a half between Dr. Williams or Thomas Paine, so we wouldn't have to provide transportation. However, Thomas Paine's kindergarten numbers are a little bit higher than they were high this year, and I have an exact number. Well, it's pretty small right now. So right now we know of 14 students from Thomas Paine who will be going into kindergarten, which is smaller than this year. This year they had really large kindergartens. We even had to open a K-1. So that might be a really viable option. Yankee Ridge, I know, has space. And we're talking about growing Yankee Ridge as well, because once these students were to matriculate to another building, that would become their home school once we make that decision. So so transportation will be something we may be coming back to the board to talk about once we have centralized registration in July. So based on the number of students that we get pre-registered, there's a really strong possibility that Dr. Williams will not participate in centralized registration. So if we can get all of our returning students that are coming back to register, as well as fill all four kindergartens with those 88 spaces, they would not be registering new families during centralized registration. And hopefully by then, when we see who comes out and registers for Thomas Paine and Yankee Ridge, we would very soon be making decisions about where new incoming families would go. I think one of the big factors in all of this, I know if you're doing the math in your head, you're thinking, well, that's not 435. Mobility is a big factor at Dr. Williams. They had 77 families who were there last year who didn't come back. So if we think about that, if we have 50 to 70 families not return, and we keep as many families who are there now who know they're coming back, we will be at our 435 with the new incoming kindergartners. Unfortunately, that means new people who move into the area expecting to go to Dr. Williams would not be allowed to go there once school started, unless there was space. And we realize we know that might happen, but that is kind of where we are now. So I know you have a lot of questions. So that's why these guys are sitting at the table to help me with those.
I got a big one.
Board members, yes. Questions?
I have a big one. Of those 435, I'm going to say it again, how many of them live over in that area? Because I've been seeing grandmas drop them off from Champaign, and we're going to have to do better as far as our screening. That's not fair to our Urbana kids, because your school is so good over there, and I understand that, but it's not fair. And Jennifer, you said those 435, but not all of those kids are Dr. Preston Williams' kids. So that's one thing we've got to get to the bottom of. They're not. I don't know. You said the clerical staff is doing the registration.
Yes.
We're going to have to look at more
so
documentation.
So maybe what we can do
is. We really
is,
are.
And I think part of it is our centralized registration procedures. I mean, we try to red flag as many residency concerns. I don't know, Don, look like you were going to say something. Do you want to respond to that? So. Okay, so I do know that you've expressed that concern before, yes, and I know that every year when we have centralized registration, we try very hard to flag families that we want to ask questions. I mean, we never want to make people feel unwelcome, but we know that there are people who move, and as you said, our schools are so wonderful, they want to continue to stay. And at registration, we try to red flag those as much as we can, but unfortunately, there are opportunities that people get by. And we need to know, like when we talked before, if we don't know who those people are, and we haven't had any, so one of the things that we red flag is when we have return mail. That's one of our ways that we know that people have moved and are no longer where they are. And Yvonda and Danielle can talk to other ways that they...
Before you guys expand on the answer, I'd like to expand the question to include petitioners versus people that live there as well. Because petition is an annual basis in Urbana, and it should be on a space available basis, not on the fact that you went to the school the year before.
And right now they only have three petitioners. They have four dual language petitioners and three petitioners that are petitioning in the building. So seven students out of 496 are petitioners. So a small number. And we did not accept any petitioners this year because when they finished registering, their number was already in the 400s, so we knew before we went through the petition process in August that we should not accept any, and we did not. So the only returning petitioners are siblings. So we didn't accept any new petitioners. And Yvonda sent quite a few people back to their home schools because she had a lot more than that before, but this year we only accepted those three.
What documents do you take?
What
documents do you take? Because the medical cards.
I think Yvonda also wanted to.
She wanted to say
to respond
else.
To the first question before we move on.
Oh, I did. I wanted to speak a little bit. Can you hear me? All righty. So we've done. Good evening. We've done a couple of things this year to try to make sure we are tracking legit residency in Urbana. Anytime someone tells us that they are living in Champaign, we do mail checks, and we send a piece of mail to the address that we've been provided with. If that is returned, then we have another letter we send out to them stating you need to come in and prove your residency in Urbana. Mm-hmm. Please note, though, we do have some cases where anytime a student is noted that they are homeless, mm-hmm. they are allowed to stay at that school for a whole mm-hmm. entire year, and then next year, and we do explain this to them, that next year you will have to go to the school in which the neighborhood that you do live in. Mm-hmm. We've tried to check everyone that we possibly can, mm-hmm. Knowing that some, just very few, mm-hmm. may get through, but we're working on that too as well, yes. Mm-hmm. But we are really trying to make sure that, you know, although a lot of people, they do want to come to Dr. Preston L. Williams Junior Elementary School, we cannot have the same capacity mm-hmm. this year as we will going into next year. Mm-hmm. It's just a lot of overloading. We don't have anywhere else. We have one kindergarten class right now sitting at 25, mm-hmm. And we have one sitting at 24, and I had two new kindergartners come in today to register. Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying is, yes, although all the classroom numbers may not show that all of my classrooms are over, the building capacity number is just a lot for Danielle and myself to keep up on a daily basis. We do what we can do, and we keep getting better at what we do. We're just asking for a little relief in that capacity number. Any other questions?
Your question.
Okay, I just wanted to know what document you use, because power bills, insurance cards don't do it anymore, because they make those up now on the computers. I'm just saying, I saw that as one document. They can put State Farm sticker on there and say, here's my insurance. So I want to know, what documents are you using to verify their residency?
On the standard enrollment form, what we do is we ask them really for a lease, something that says that, yes, they reside in Urbana at this address that is from a leasing agent. Now, however, if they do not have that, then they have to provide two other following documents. One can be an ID, and it could be an ID, but it has to be a current Urbana address. They can't tell us that they moved and they haven't updated anything. We will not accept that at all. And then the other thing can be a bill. And the bill has to be a current bill. It has to be in their name, cannot be in someone else's name. And it has to match the address that they are registering. All three things, or all both things, have to match. We have had some cases where they do not match, and we have denied them and turned them away. and we ask them to go to their prospective schools or even to Champaign Unit 4. So we are making sure, and Danielle and myself, we are double checking when we have people come out. If they do not have the proper information, we send them either to go get an affidavit. If they say they're living with someone, we have to have some type of proof in order to make sure we are following our procedures. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
So, and I have a question. I'm very grateful for how well you guys have handled the huge numbers you've had all year. I mean, each month when we get those numbers, they just kept going up and up and up, and I kept waiting for the roof to blow off the school one of these days. So thank you for doing such a good job doing that. And I'm in total support of measures that we need to take to balance the enrollment better across our district. My question is I understand families would have two viable options, you know, Thomas Paine or Yankee Ridge, and, you know, and hopefully most of the families would find one or the other of those, you know. But if it sounds like we're talking about 50 or 60 families or children, I guess, what about those families who don't find either of those options, you know, livable? What's the next, what do you do in those cases?
Well, we haven't talked about that, but I think, I'm looking at Dr. Owen, but he's writing. I think in some of the extenuating circumstances, you're right, I don't know, we haven't talked about really implement, you know, how the petitioning process might fit into this. Uh-huh. But I think if we're providing transportation, we want families to be as close as they can to their neighborhood. I mean, we don't want people to be so far away from where they're living that they can't get to things like parent-teacher conferences and family nights. And so that's why we settled on place Thomas Paine, Yankee Ridge. And we were really originally talking about Wiley as well. That was an option. Mm-hmm. But Wiley's kindergarten numbers, we already know they have 40 kindergartners coming from Urbana Early Childhood. Mm-hmm. So we said, well, you know, we probably need to not include Wiley as an option at this time, maybe later if those numbers change. But the reason we chose those buildings, because mm-hmm. they are closer to the mm-hmm. Prairie neighborhood. Okay. And we want we know a lot of families at Prairie, at Dr. Williams, or in the Prairie neighborhood may not have a car, mm-hmm. they may be using public transportation, and we want families to still be able to get to wherever they are assigned mm-hmm. for family events. So that's why we didn't go with places like King, or Leo, who we're trying to, you know, watch the numbers there as well.
So there might be some other options to consider.
Well, I want to add to the discussion, though, at this point, that I'm a little concerned about adding students to Yankee Ridge when it's going to be under major construction for the next year. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's moving students from one stressful situation to potentially another stressful situation mm-hmm. with a building under construction while the students are present. So just mm-hmm. I want to add that to the conversation.
And that is a good point, but Yankee Ridge's numbers are significantly lower than they have been. They are at 273, mm-hmm. 275, and they are usually around 325, 330. So they've lost 40 to 50 students. And as we've said in the past, whenever we add on a remodel, of course, more families come. And I think we're going to be allowing for that in the new construction. But their numbers are lower, and that's one of the reasons why we talked about Yankee Ridge, because they have had, you know, in the last couple of years, 320 easily. Mm-hmm. And they're, staying around that 275 area right now.
That's exactly right. I mean, one of the things that we want to do, one of the reasons why Yankee Ridge is on the table is because, especially if the board looks at the, I guess it's at alternate one, which mm-hmm. is the additional classrooms, we want to make sure that that will be a school that has, students attending. It makes most sense to move there. And Dr. Ivor Tatum is correct that their high from two or three years ago is quite a bit higher than where they would be even if we moved most of these students there for next year. So that's one of the reasons why Yankee Ridge is on the table. The other thing I want to say, I just want to finish up. I think the idea of if those options are not satisfactory for the family, it would be a petitioning process, just mm-hmm. like any family that said, hey, this is, this school, for whatever reason that I live in this neighborhood and I'm supposed to attend this school, mm-hmm. it'd be the same kind of thing. It would mm-hmm. be a petition. Mm-hmm. And as Dr. Ivor Tatum said, we are aware that there will be transportation costs regardless of what we do, mm-hmm. because we can't guarantee that any family moving in is going to move in within walking distance of Thomas Paine or of Yankee Ridge. So there will be transportation costs with either option.
And I just wanted to point out to the board that this year we had our configurations in July and everything, and after centralized registration, we realized we were over our number already. Mm-hmm. This year we had 39 kindergartners that we did not have listed anywhere on our list. Mm-hmm. So 39. So if we have 88 that are slated, 86 to 88 is coming from early childhood, that doesn't take into account the ones that have not registered. Mm-hmm. That was the purpose of the pre-enrollment forms. We're asking them, do you have anyone at home that is not in any type of school setting? So that we can catch them that way. And we did an incentive with the teachers to make sure we got back majority of those blue forms. And so that's how we've tried to catch people. And then as we find out that kids are moving, we've been able to also subtract them from those numbers as well.
All right, other questions, board members? All right, well, how are we going from here?
This process is actually just a kind of an update, because as we talked about at the beginning of the year, this we look at as an administrative solution. Mm-hmm. This isn't a full-blown redistricting. We wanted to provide the board an opportunity to ask questions and have input, but essentially this is one solution that we are going to implement as kind of an administrative solution. To the redistricting problem, or to not the redistricting, the
enrollment
issues at Dr. Williams for next year. And so we're not asking for board approval on this, but we do want to make sure that the board is up to date on what our thinking is. Again, the committee's met several times. We wanted to give you an update on where we're at and what our plans are moving forward.
And I think this is great.
Yeah.
Okay.
No.
I actually have one last question. What's the trend? I mean, how long has this been, how long has the population been growing? And is there any possibility that with Yankee Ridge being remodeled, that will take some pressure off long term?
I can answer that question.
Okay, you start with that trend and I'll start with
that. Sure. Our third grade group right now currently has 5 classrooms. That was our kindergarten group that was 105 when we ended the school year for that kindergarten year. Okay. Ever since that year, our kindergarten trend has increased over the years. So it started with our third grade group that we currently have right now.
And I was going to say that's typical of what happened at King. The first 2 or 3 years after, we did have increased numbers, but then now they've leveled off and the neighborhood is pretty stabilized, I would say, at this time in terms of housing. That hasn't happened yet in the Dr. Williams neighborhood, but we did have a good, I'd say, I don't know, Don, 2 or 3 years where our numbers were a little higher and then they
it's further
leveled
evidence
off.
That every time we work on a school,
it's not just that. I mean, 4 or 5 years ago, we decided, one of the reasons the board decided to place the dual language program in at that time Prairie was because there were 4 empty classrooms in the building.
Language program has added to one of the reasons, you know, I think why the building is so popular is just brought another element of positivity to the whole building and just the program itself.
Yeah, we typically have double digit waiting lists of folks on the waiting list to get in that are petitioning from other schools to come to Dr. Williams for dual language, and that we haven't been able to let petitioning families in because of the increase in numbers.
I was going to say the growth has been neighborhood, though.
Primarily.
You told me before that it's what do you call that in high tech industry? It's the organic growth of the school in that neighborhood. It's not external.
Right.
It drives home the pressure that we need to open up another DL program somewhere.
That's a conversation that we definitely could have. I mean, obviously, if the dual language program wasn't there, there would be fewer students in the building. But the way in which our housing across the community works, the majority of our students who qualify for dual language, Spanish-speaking, bilingual families, would be going to a school somewhere across Urbana. And so whether it's a Dr. Williams or another school, that's the conversation that we have to
They're part of that underserved north side.
Yeah, there's not a school within walking distance where many families live, right? Yeah. So it's a we used to have this conversation at Leal before we moved to Dr. Williams. So.
Yeah. And isn't there a housing for the migrant workers over that way also, somewhere in that area? And then they end up staying too?
Yeah, there are some. We have a small number of migrant farm working families mm-hmm. who stay into the fall.
They're from Texas, but they stay.
Yeah, from Texas. Mm-hmm. It's a very small number in the fall. But I'm blanking on the name of the complex behind the gas station on Washington. There is a place where many migrant farm workers live while they're here. They do. And it's actually expanding now across Urbana and across Champaign. It primarily out of Rantoul is where many families go to for work. So.
Okay. Can I just ask Joel, I mean, this is sort of when you mentioned the long waiting list of language at Dr. Williams, is that the case at Leal too? I mean, do we have long waiting lists across the district now?
There's a waiting list at both schools. It depending on the year of how many classrooms are in kindergarten at each school dictates the amount, the length of the waiting list. So. There was less of a waiting list at Leal this year, but because there were two dual language kindergarten classrooms there and one at Dr. Williams. So if that pattern holds true, next year having two dual language kindergartens at Dr. Williams would mean there would be less of a waiting list because there's more spots, but probably a bigger waiting list at Leal.
And if someone is on a waiting list and they don't get into a dual language, what do they typically do? Do they go to another school or?
So if they're a petitioning family, they either petition to the school anyway. Mm-hmm. Or they stay at their home school and reapply in first grade. Mm-hmm. We've had several families that haven't gotten in at kindergarten and have reapplied and have gotten in at first grade.
Oh, because that's more likely to
the case. Numbers can typically, contract class size language goes up in first grade, and so we're able to allow new students in.
Okay, good. Yeah. Thank you.
All right, other questions? No approval by the school board is required at this point. This is administrative action. This is just informational. So thank you.
Thanks,
Jennifer.
No, thank you.
We'll keep you posted.
Thank you. All right. Next on our agenda is we have no future special or executive meetings scheduled. We do have a superintendent's report, I assume.
If I could, I'd like to have the board do their report first, and I'd like my report after.
Sure. Board reports this evening.
I'd like to say I was very happy to attend the Read Across America. I was a greeter there. It was very nice to see so many children and parents and family participating in a great family activity. This is put on every year, and it's a very good community event. So I was very happy to attend that. Also, I would like to remind everybody there is a Illinois State Board of Education dinner in Rantoul on Thursday that we'll be going to learn more of what's going on. They usually give us updates, government updates with what's happening in the state, and it's also a learning experience for us where we can stay informed and keep up to date with being a board member.
Other board reports. Want to mention the Champaign-Urbana Schools Foundation annual gala. They're recognizing for Urbana Robert Mock. Shirley Mock's. Shirley worked for me in Head Start, and so I'm quite familiar with the family, and it's a great honor. He's president of a university, and so he will be recognized as the distinguished alumni for Urbana. And her, yes. And I've drawn an absolute blank. The local hero award is
Aaron Grace.
Yes, Aaron Grace. Class of 92, I believe, was her class. And so those will be the two Urbana-related folks that will be recognized that evening. So I encourage anyone that wants to purchase a ticket. It's the biggest fundraiser for the school's foundation in a year. And it's pretty important that we recognize our success stories. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other board reports this evening? Don?
Thank you. I know several people in the audience know one of the things I'm about to say. I'd like to try and get through the other one first. Okay. I had the honor of attending the Orchestra Cup, which is a national competition this weekend with the UHS Orchestra and Tamara Gingold, who was a graduate of Urbana herself and is back as the orchestra director. There were 10 of the best orchestras in the country that competed, and Urbana did very well. The students were amazing, and we had a great time, with the exception of the bus trip.
But
that's another story. But I'd also like to thank the other chaperones. As I said, Ms. Gingold led the orchestra in an amazing performance in Lincoln Center on Saturday morning. But I was joined by other parents, Rebecca Brown, Damian Davis, Stephen Cosper, and Ryan Larson. So I'd like to thank them, and also thank the students. It was a great time, and we enjoyed ourselves a great deal.
Yeah, much sleep.
No. I've received a number of texts in the last 15 minutes or so, and some of you in the audience have also received them. It's with deep sadness that I announce that Deacon Willie Somerville passed away this evening.
Really?
And as you know, Mr. Somerville was a force in music education, not just here in Urbana, but literally around the country. He was a good friend. He was a mentor. And he was a beloved teacher to many of our students. I think we just need a moment of silence and adjourn, because people need to go home and grieve. Mr. Summer will be truly missed.
Move adjournment.
Yeah. Second. Moved and seconded. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Motions carry. Do you want to do that tonight, or do you want to come back?
You guys can go dance.
We need to go into executive session. I'm sorry, our motion to adjourn is to adjourn to executive session. There'll be no action afterwards.